Random House Audio presents Shiloh, a guided tour from Jeff Shaara's Civil War battlefields. What happened, why it matters, and what to see, by Jeff Shaara. Read for you by Robertson Dean. Shiloh. Shiloh Church, Tennessee, April 6th to 7th, 1862. What happened here? The Battle of Shiloh is the first truly horrifying large-scale battle of the Western theater of the Civil War. But to best understand the importance of Shiloh, it is important first to understand what had preceded it. It had been nearly a year since the war had begun, with the shelling of Fort Sumter at Charleston, South Carolina, and in the North, the concept of a full-scale rebellion and what to do about it was difficult to digest. In the South, the drive for secession had been driven first by politicians, but politicians don't carry a musket. And as the energy for rebellion spread throughout the southern states, the first priority was the creation of some kind of effective army. Predictions came from both sides that this entire affair would be concluded in short order. But as each army added men and training, while the leadership sorted through their various commanders, the noisy bluster from the politicians was replaced by the hard rumble of battle. It was the awful consequence of secession and rebellion that neither side had ever truly expected. The first significant battle of the war had taken place in July 1861 in Northern Virginia, only a few miles from the nation's capital. The social elite of Washington had gathered in celebratory anticipation, picnicking on the sunny hillsides near Bull Run Creek to watch the spectacle as though it were some grand carnival. While most of the northern observers had assumed that their gallant boys in blue would sweep aside the ragtag army of rebels and put an immediate end to this absurd notion of rebellion, the reality instead spread a hard shock through the entire country. Confederate troops under Generals Joe Johnston and Pierre G.T. Beauregard had sent the panicked and thoroughly whipped Union forces scrambling back to the safety of Washington, along with the hundreds of terrified onlookers. In the North, the battle was called Bull Run, while in the South, it was known as Manassas, after the small railroad junction nearby. This kind of distinction was to be repeated throughout the war, the North referring to waterways, the South to towns. For the Union leadership, absorbing the reality of what happened that day caused a somewhat stunned reappraisal of how they were going to deal with this rebellion by the southern states, which had now become a bloody and clearly dangerous affair. While Abraham Lincoln and his generals fumbled with their vague strategies, they began to realize that if this war was in fact to become a drawn-out military confrontation, they had to rely much more on a sound overall plan to defeat the rebels. They had to contend with another reality as well. The Southern Army was being led by men who had once been some of the highest-ranking and most experienced commanders in the United States military. Both sides of the conflict regarded the Appalachian Mountains as the dividing line between East and West, and the keys to travel across that country lay along the vital pathways of the rivers and railroads. At the beginning of the war, Union General-in-Chief Winfield Scott had formulated his Anaconda Plan, designed to quickly subdue the rebellion by strangling the economies of the southern states. Scott's plan called for the Navy to blockade southern seaports and, as well, clamp a tight hold on the Mississippi River. But Scott was an old man, past his time, and his plan was generally ridiculed, since no one believed that the rebellion would ever become so serious as to require such a widespread and expensive strategy. Scott was forced into retirement, replaced by George McClellan, an extremely capable administrator and organizer, something the Union Army desperately required. But as events of that first July would prove, the Union also required generals who could effectively lead their troops into combat. Bull Run had shocked much of the Union leadership into a fever pitch of planning, something McClellan excelled at. But for the next several months, there was very little activity on the eastern battlefields, certainly nothing to compare with what had happened at Bull Run Creek. As the Union soldiers around Washington drilled and waited for McClellan to tell them what to do, In the West, where the Mississippi River served as the great lifeline for both North and South, a great game of chess was being played. Union command there was held by General Henry Halleck, and though Halleck had not proven himself in the field any more than George McClellan, Halleck's department was far more active. Whether or not Halleck and his generals gave any credit to Winfield Scott, the commanders in the West understood that the Mississippi River and its major tributaries might hold the key to winning the war for either side. In the field, Halleck's unheralded commanders, such as Samuel Curtis and Don Carlos Buell, had begun to show some competence in leading their men to victories. But it was a relatively unknown commander, Ulysses S. Grant, who suddenly caught the attention of both Halleck and the anxious planners in Washington. Grant was a veteran of the Mexican War, but during the chaotic days of Gold Rush San Francisco, he had succumbed to the effects of alcohol, and in the early 1850s, he had been forced to resign from the Army in disgrace. Having spent several years as a civilian, Grant was virtually ignored when he joined the Union effort, especially since his elevation to command had come through connections, friendships with prominent politicians in Illinois. Halleck had few expectations of Grant until February 1862, when Grant stunned his superiors by accomplishing the most significant Union victories of the war thus far. Confederate troop positions throughout western Kentucky and Tennessee had been protected by strong bases at two key points, Forts Henry and Donelson, on the Tennessee and Cumberland Rivers in northwestern Tennessee. With the cooperation of Navy gunboats commanded by Admiral Andrew Foote, Grant succeeded in capturing both strongholds, capturing nearly half the Confederate troops he faced. The loss had so weakened the Confederate forces in the area that they were forced to vacate Kentucky altogether. A jubilant Abraham Lincoln ordered that Grant be sent a shipment of 10,000 cigars. Ever after, the pipe-smoking Grant would become, logically enough, a cigar smoker. The Confederates west of the Appalachian Mountains were commanded by General Albert Sidney Johnston, who had been a highly respected officer in the Mexican War, and in the 1850s had led a major expedition of the U.S. Army to California. Johnston had greatly dismayed Washington when he chose to remain loyal to his home state of Texas and join the Confederate cause. Now he was confronting many of the same commanders he had once served with. Johnston recognized how precarious his position in Tennessee had become, and with the key Confederate forts now in Grant's hands, Johnston ordered his troops southward to consolidate their position. The Southern military had little naval force sufficient to prevent the Union Navy from controlling the rivers, and Union gunboats continued to push their way deeper into Confederate territory. With the Union Navy now threatening to surround much of Johnston's army, Johnston made the only reasonable decision open to him. He ordered the Confederate forces to move south again, and to the horror of the Confederate politicians in Richmond, he abandoned Nashville. Though he had sacrificed a major rail and supply center, the move was strategically sound, if not politically popular, and might have saved his army from early destruction. With Nashville falling into federal control and a strong foothold now established in central Tennessee, Union troops were massed for a surge southward again. The waterways provided the easiest routes, and Halleck made great use of his transport boats to shift a large concentration of federal troops up the Tennessee River toward the Mississippi state line. Their goal would now be to cut the Memphis and Charleston Railroad, the crucial railway line that connected Memphis to Chattanooga, the most prominent artery for Confederate supplies and troop movements, and the lifeline that ultimately connected Tennessee to Virginia. Halleck ordered his generals to concentrate their forces near Savannah, Tennessee, less than 20 miles from the Mississippi state line. Halleck was not an especially bold strategist and insisted that his generals assemble overwhelming strength before making any aggressive move against Johnston's rebels. Once the huge force was in place, the Union troops would march southward to capture the town of Corinth, Mississippi, the closest of the critical railway depots. In late March 1862, as five Union divisions established their camps, the cramped logistics of the landing area at Savannah caused them to seek better ground, and a force of nearly 40,000 men moved a few miles farther south, upriver to Pittsburg Landing. But Halleck ordered Grant's army to wait so that
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.